We teach girls to shrink themselves, to make themselves smaller. We say to girls, you can have ambition, but not too much. You should aim to be successful, but not too successful. Otherwise, you will threaten the man. Because I am female, I'm expected to aspire to marriage. I'm expected to make my life choices, always keeping in mind that marriage is the most important. A marriage can be a source of joy and love and mutual support. But why do we teach girls to aspire to marriage and we don't teach boys the same? We raise girls to see each other as competitors, not for jobs or for accomplishments, which I think can be a good thing, but for the attention of men. We teach girls that they cannot be sexual beings in the way that boys are. Feminist, a person who believes in the social, political, and economic equality of the sexes.
I chose to introduce this video with a strong feminist message since this was a common theme throughout Artemisia Gentileschi's magnificent artworks. She was a great Italian Baroque artist who achieved something so close to impossible that she deserves to be one of the most famous artists in the world. Not only because she became a highly successful artist in an age when guilds and academics closed their doors to women, it is because she also did what none of the other Renaissance and Baroque women who made it as artists could manage. She communicated a powerful personal vision. Her paintings are self-evidently autobiographical. She put her life into her art. While doing that, she created a strong women empowerment statement through her paintings and life story that is still inspiring women, including myself, in the 21st century. The idea of being a strong woman who is able to defend herself in any circumstance, especially against a dominant male, and still getting back up after being hit down is a common takeaway in both the painting of Judith slaying Holofernes and her self-portrait as St. Catherine of Alexandria. Around 1612, Artemisia began to paint a popular subject, the biblical story from the Old Testament of Judith beheading Holofernes, who threatens to destroy her home. In the story, the general Holofernes desires the widow Judith. He calls her to his tent, but passes out from drinking. To protect her virtue and her people, she decapitates him. Judith is shown as a beautiful woman who entices Holofernes and also as a fierce heroine. The subject was popular among Renaissance artists, including artist Caravaggio. Most art historians believe Artemisia had personal reasons to paint this violent subject, since a tragedy did happen to her at the age of 17. Agostino Tassi, a young painter who had befriended her father, was asked to instruct Artemisia on techniques and perspective. Tassi accepted the offer, but one day while her father was working away, Tassi persuaded Artemisia's chaperone to leave the two alone during their lesson. The neighbor left, and Tassi had raped Artemisia. Since women were not allowed to declare a trial of their own, her father announced the rape to the courts, and Tassi was brought to trial in 1612. But her tragedies did not stop there. During Tassi's 7-month trial, midwives physically examined Artemisia in front of a judge who demanded that her hands be tortured and crushed in order to see if she changed her story under pressure. Although she was the victim in the trial, she was the one tortured as the guilty man sat with ease watching. This event in itself shows how little rights women had, since she was questioned if it really was true. The sense of doubt in women is still present in our society today, with rape victims being accused of asking for it by the way they dress or talk. Her saga is meticulously documented in some 300 pages of court records. Many believe that Artemisia was taking revenge with this painting and changing the ending to her traumatizing sexist story. There actually exist two blood-drenched paintings of Judith and Holofernes by Gentileschi surviving, one in Capo di Monte in Naples, the other in the Uffizi in Florence. They are almost identical except for small details. In Naples, Judith's dress is blue and Florence yellow, as if this image was a nightmare she kept having. Artemisia also brings out an element of the biblical story no male artist had ever dwelt on. In most paintings, including the well-known Baroque artist Caravaggio's hallucinatory rendering, Judith has a servant who waits to collect the severed head, but Artemisia makes the servant a strong young woman who actively participates in the killing. This does two things. It adds a savage realism that even Caravaggio never thought of. It would take two women to kill this man, but it also gives the scene a revolutionary implication. Artemisia wonders, if women get together, could we fight back against a world ruled by men? Like faces, hands also have a gender. A common feature drawn by Artemisia on all the women in her paintings is unusually strong forearms and firm hands. It is through their hands that Artemisia's women take on the world and confront adversity. This is shown in Judith and the Servant while decapitating the man. Since there is a lot of action involved with the figures and scenes Artemisia draws, she creates an impressive movement throughout her paintings. Also, the texture and flow included in the fabric she paints is undeniably exquisite. The exuberant colors of her work are a popular aspect since it creates the dramatic theme that is eye-catching to the viewers. Her use of contrast is another important element since it creates such a real dimension in all the portraits and figures, also making the horror component even more vibrant with the darkened background. The most important aspect of Artemisia's legacy is definitely the trials and tribulations that stood in her way, yet she still managed to excel in the face of adversity. Although she was a woman, a rape victim, a victim of suppression, a victim of abuse, she remained poised and brilliant. Instead of letting society and the people and events in her life bring her down, she got up and got her revenge with the paintbrush, which led her to becoming the magnificent, most prestigious, influential painter of the Baroque period. Someone I can truly say I am both inspired by and look up to as a female 400 years later. The relevance of her artwork and message of feminism still remains in our society today. So to say she was far beyond her years is an understatement. She made a brave statement most women in the 1600s would have only dared to. Although some of her famous artworks gruesomely portray this feminist message, it shows how passionately she felt about being an oppressed woman in the 17th century. Many art historians have felt that stereotypical assumptions will be made of Artemisia because of the anger towards men present in some of her works like Judith slaying Holofernes. But being a victim of rape and betrayal by a man is part of Artemisia's story, so her expression of these events transcribes through her artwork. In contrast, she has many pieces like her self-portrait dressed as Saint Catherine, which shows the strength she produces. Although humiliated and tortured, she remains a stand tall and respectable. This painting depicts Saint Catherine of Alexandria, whose legend is extraordinary. Catherine was the daughter of Constance, the governor of Egypt's Alexandria. She scolded the emperor for his paganistic cruelty, and he allegedly organized a debate between her and 50 of his best philosophers, which she famously won. She was then tortured and ultimately beheaded after escaping a spiked wheel seen in Gentileschi's portrait. The self-portrait is commonly seen as a subtle parallel to Artemisia's past, drawing on Saint Catherine to symbolize suffering that was overcome and violence that was endured. The spiked wheel is broken in Artemisia's painting, which is also symbolic of her escape from the torture she went through in her life. A look into Gentileschi's eyes sees her staring right back. As the artist once proclaimed, "You will find the spirit of Caesar in the soul of a woman." Being a strong feminist is part of Artemisia's impressive artistry. Because of her life events that led to her restrictions, it is important to understand her story. It makes her accomplishments that much more significant. From being the first woman accepted into the Academy of the Arts of Drawing in Florence, and being a well-known popular painter during her time alive, were all things women of the Baroque time period were restricted from doing, making her historical evidence that the most impossible things are indeed possible. Hi, so now we're going to do the makeup and hair tutorial on how to look like one of the badass heroines in Artemisia Gentileschi's paintings. And we're going to start off with some moisturizer. And just blend it all over your face evenly. And then we're going to move on to foundation. You're going to want a good canvas for the rest of the makeup to be applied, so your foundation is applied evenly. I'm going to be using a beauty blender for this portion. Obviously, you can use a brush, whatever your preference is. Just make sure the foundation is applied nicely. Next step is going to be concealer, and we're just going to place this in areas that you want to diminish. You want to place it under your eyes for the dark circles, and then for your cupid's bow, your chin, and the top of your nose, since that's going to highlight those areas. And go ahead and just make sure to blend the concealer into the foundation nicely so there's no harsh lines. Next, we're going to be taking a setting powder. You're just going to place that in all the areas that would crease since we want this to last a while. This will also create a matte surface for the other powders you're going to place on. For example, the contour shade we're going to use right now. And you're just going to take that in the hollows of your cheeks. This is to bring back the dimensions since we did take away all that with the concealer and the foundation. And just to make sure we don't look like an egg, we're going to contour the shadows of our face. We're now moving on to blush, which is a very vital portion of this tutorial since many of the Renaissance and Baroque paintings do consist of blushed portraits. And we're just going to pack on the blush on the cheeks, the nose, a little bit on the chin, and on the forehead. Moving on to highlighter, we're just going to add a little shimmer to where a light would normally catch those highlights of your face. So your top of your cheekbones, on your nose, your forehead, and your Cupid's bow. Okay, moving on to eyebrows, we're going to need an eyebrow pencil and some brow gel. First, we're going to take the brow gel, brush it through the hair, push up so that it gives you the more lifted look. Next, we're going to start filling in the sparse areas with just small hair-like strokes. We want this to look very natural. Next, we're going to take some concealer to clean up the bottom. If you made any mistake, this is a perfect tool to help clean it up a little bit. And then you're going to make sure to blend out the concealer. And we're done with eyebrows. Next, we're going to move on to eyeshadow. I'm going to start with a nude base for the rest of the other pigments to go on nicer. And we're going to start with a lighter transition shade. And then move on to a corally orange kind of blush pigment. You're going to bring that down to the waterline to make your eyes appear more round, since a lot of the women in her portraits did have the rounder eye. Next, we're going to place some more of that coral shade on the lids. And now you're just going to blend some more so that there's no harsh lines. Next is mascara, so you're just going to curl your lashes. And apply a few coats of mascara. Now we're done with eyes and moving on to lips. First, you're going to take a liner and line the outside of your lips. You're going to want to accentuate the Cupid's bow since this was another feature that was exaggerated in her portraits. Now we're just adding an orange nudish lipstick and we're going to blend those two together. And we're finished with the makeup look, and now we're on to the hair. So I had done some overnight curlers so that it was a little faster, but of course you could curl all of your hair with just a curling iron. But first we're going to tease some of your hair so that it gives it some of that volume, and then we're going to curl the pieces that went a little flat. Now you're just going to start bobby pinning just random places of your hair. The messier the better, honestly. This doesn't need to be perfect. The curls kind of mask any, you know, craziness. And just last minute touches. And we're done with the final look. And now you look like you belong in an Artemisia painting from the 17th century.